Are you looking for a podcast that talks about life, the universe, and everything? Listen in to the Illumination Hour, Monday nights, 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific. Listen live at Spreaker.com or NonPartisanLibertyForall.com. We're also on SoundCloud, Spreaker, Twitter, Tumblr, YouTube, and iTunes. The Illumination Hour, brought to you by Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network, and your host, Ellen Stallone. Because a spark can illuminate the world.
The world is mine, nigga, get back. Don't fuck with my stack. The gauge is racked. About to drop the bomb, I'm the motherfucking Don.
That's Bourne.
Green light, yes, sir.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time.
Are you gonna give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law, we enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man needs to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is October 18th, 2016, and I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, on the Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network, which now runs 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. And to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote self-ownership in the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. We, of course, are always happy to hear from you, and you can reach us via phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. And it'd be better if you sent a text first before you called with your name and what you wanted to talk about. That would expedite the process of getting on the air. Or you could also reach us via Skype. Send us a contact request with the same information, your name and what you want to talk about, and we'll accept that and bring you on the air. And check us out on our website, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com, where you can find links to all our social media pages, our Facebook pages, as well as Twitter and original blogs, articles. Also archives, pictures, and other things at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com, and all the contact information. If you ever forget the phone number or the Skype login, just go to nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. It's a pretty easy name to remember, I guess, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. So just remember that, and you'll be all set. So today I had an interesting concept, I guess, that I wanted to focus on. Before we get to that, I have some venting, I guess, to do. But what I wanted to talk about today was the perception of most Americans, or a lot of Americans. It's really hard to even know, but I would say it's at least a majority. Now, that really doesn't mean much when we look at the total population, and that's really what I'm talking about. When I'm talking about these false perceptions and these false interpretations of facts, which we're going to talk about, and it's, you know, I blame it on the media because they don't put it in context. And that's one of the issues, that it is not put in context when they talk about it. Now, I don't expect government media, one, to be fair anyway, but even if they were, I don't expect them to every moment remind people the percentage of population. But if it's relevant to the story, really they should actually mention the fact that there's only the – what I got based on – I got some statistics from the CDC, and I think that's where they came from. They came from a government site, but I believe they were all from the CDC. But they might have been – no, you know what? It was from a combination. I got the death – my death stats from the CDC and my population stats from the census, estimated based on the government census. So they're both from government websites. Now, people automatically think because it's the government, it means that it's true, that it's not true but accurate. And I think with population, it probably is accurate, to be honest. But with a lot of things, they're not as accurate as you think they are, with like crime statistics. And I've had discussions with people, I guess I would call them insiders, that know a lot of this for a fact and have seen certain things, I guess, in action. So I do know that a lot of these stats, when you look at them, you know, in general, depending on what you're looking at, may be somewhat accurate. First of all, you have to think about what you're looking at and how it would benefit, or if it would benefit the government in any way, to try to massage the stats. Now, it doesn't mean that it's not accurate because they're putting in false information per se. They could be massaging the data or using a different way of calculating. So the same way we have this perception that people interpret certain things in a certain way that the media present, government media presents, it's kind of the same way with stats. Like the inflation rate we were talking about last week with Ken Shorgen of the Daily Economist. And you can also catch him on Ken Shorgen, the YouTube channel, Ken Shorgen. He has his own little podcast going on there a couple times a week. So it depends on the type of stats you're looking at. And then you got to think about how or if it would benefit the government to massage the stats, which doesn't always mean it's wrong. It could be inaccurate for a number of reasons. With some crime statistics, you don't have a lot of people that report on them. Or with a lot of people don't know this, and this is actually something to mention that pertains to what I was going to talk about, is that the government, they might have started, but if they did, they started very recently. They never tracked, the FBI didn't track people killed by police because they said, why would they? There's no need to. There's no, nobody asked or some shit like that. Like, nobody required us to or asked, or really it's who gives a fuck, because we don't care if police kill people because we believe they deserved it and we don't want people knowing anyway. So they did have a number, but it was a bullshit number because they'd only base it off of whoever reported to them. So most places aren't going to even bother reporting that number. So they didn't make an effort to track that information down or get any accurate numbers or validate them or whatever. Now, I don't know what their process is on other crime statistics for validation. What I'm told is it is similar in that it's based on reporting, but most police stations do issue their own reports. So I'm sure there's some validation that goes on. So I would consider them somewhat accurate. And, you know, that's really the closest thing we have to accurate statistics when it comes to crime. Not police officers shooting people. That is tracked independently by a non-government entities, and that's who you're going to want to believe anyway. So essentially, when it comes to these statistics, you know, again, statistics in general, it all depends on the statistics you're looking at and how or why they would want to manipulate them. And like I said, they could be technically true, but they massage them or use a different calculation than they did before for something like inflation or things like that. So just so everybody is aware. So I wanted to talk a little about the corporate world, and I'm going to try to be as non-specific as possible because this pertains directly to me, and I don't mention where I work at on purpose. Although, for all I know, because I do know people at work that are aware of the show, some of them, I made them aware of the show, which may have been a mistake, meaning, you know, I gave them the card, but I figured, well, one, you could find out anyway, and two, I didn't think they were going to listen, so, which I don't think they did, but I don't know. So I could be being discriminated against for all I know. I'm not saying that I am, because that's a serious allegation, but it's possible. And I don't think anybody would really care if I was for this anyway, including the government, of course, because what the fuck do they care? I'm bad-mouthing them. But, you know, the corporate world is such fucking bullshit, which I, you know, when I was younger, for a little while, I got into that mentality. Yeah, if you just, you know, work hard and try to get ahead and all of this shit, that now, I never believed in the government side of it or the police side of it that, you know, if you work hard and try to get ahead that the police won't fuck with you or anything like that or the government won't fuck with you. No. But that you could move up in a corporation and actually become whatever you wanted within that corporation, which then you get into, you know, the higher you get, the more you see the political part of it, which I saw from the beginning. But not only do you see the political part of it, and the only reason I think I kind of got into that for a little while is because for some reason, this was years ago, probably about 10 years ago, I was being like accepted. And not only was I being accepted by these corporate people, they thought at least they acted like some of them thought like I was cool, like the older ones, because I was, you know, still in my 20s. And they treated me like, you know, they'd curse around me, but they wouldn't really around other people. And they talked to me like, you know, it wasn't like they talked down to me. Like, this is, I remember a conversation with the vice president, the CFO of the company. I think at the time he was the controller slash vice president, you know, controller of accounting. And he later became the CFO. But I remember they invited me out with all the directors and to have drinks, and how he was talking to me and like I was, you know, one of them, but I was cool. It's hard to explain, but, you know, he was like cursing to me and saying, fuck, you know, whatever. And I almost felt like, for a minute, almost literally, not in that moment, but there was other things that happened that made me feel somewhat accepted, that I was accepted by this corporate world, which I had never been a part of. You know, yeah, I have a master's degree. I have my MBA. I'm college educated, but I grew up, I've talked about this before, not poor, but not... I don't know how I describe it, because I wouldn't call myself middle class. We lived in an apartment. I always had to share a room with my brother until I was 21, and then we finally rented a duplex. Never owned a house and didn't have money to go on family vacations or anything like that. I mean, the only reason why my parents had two cars is because my father got a car from his company when he was a dispatcher at a cab company prior to, you know, or after he was a cab driver, and then he went back to being a cab driver. And my mom, her side of the family did have some money, her parents, and they gave her their car. And their car was like 6 years old, but they were old and they never went anywhere. So you had this 84 Blazer that in like 1990 had 20,000 miles on it. Six-year-old car with 20,000 miles on it, which is really good. I mean, my fiance's car is, what, 3 years old? She has 40 already. So that's the only reason my parents even had, you know, my mom didn't even have a car before that. So and when we were kids, when my mom didn't work, my father was probably working 80 hours a week, literally, at least doing like double shifts, dispatching and stuff like that. I mean, I'm not even, you know, I was too young to remember not seeing him, because, you know, this is when I was a baby, and probably until... I don't know. I'd have to ask my mother, you know, how long that went on for. But she stayed home, I think, until my brother went to school. And then she got a job. And her first job was like at McDonald's, because she had graduated high school and got married. And then, you know, now she actually works in an office in accounting. She's been working in the same for the same company for like almost 30 years or something. So, and damn, that would put her in her 30s, her early 30s, I guess, is when she started there, if she had been there that long. I know that the company before that, she had at least been there, which was, she had a similar job. She had been there maybe it's 30 years together. Maybe she'd been at that company 25 years. I don't know. But so by her early 30s, she had a pretty good job. So, but it was back years ago where it was easier to get that type of job. Although when I was in accounting, I saw girls with just a high school diploma getting, being hired and ended up, getting into doing accounting. So who knows? But going back to the corporate world, you know, I didn't really change per se or anything like that, but it was like, I wouldn't say it went to my head neither, but I bought into it for a little while. Not for that long, because then reality sets in and you see, you know, things that happened that had nothing to do with me, but with the company. And then you see how you're treated when you're not as important and you don't do what they want you to do. They wanted me to. I ended up getting into process improvement within accounting and writing reports and things like that. And they wanted me to come back and be a manager in accounting. And I had just gotten a raise and I knew what the job was going to be, because I basically, it was like going back to my prior job, except it was a manager title and maybe I'd have some people working under me. That's kind of what they, and I'd be making more money. But I asked for even more, and that really pissed off the, he became the CFO at that point, and he was all mad at me and whatever, and I guess that kind of fucked things up. And then there was shit with the company where they did illegal stuff, and they got bought out and whatever. So I went from there to another company, still kind of having that, okay, you know, I can have a career at a corporation type thing. And, you know, every fucking thing that they said that was going to happen didn't happen. Now, granted, I'm sure a lot of it was out of their control. Like, we were, they brought me in to help implement an accounting system, and that never happened. It happened, but I had been long gone by the time it did, because they had closed their Las Vegas office. So you have this, I guess, kind of idea like, yeah, I can, I guess, be Mr. Corporate Man and fucking, you know, all this shit. And like I said, at the same time, you know, I still felt the way I did when it came to police and government and stuff like that, but I just didn't focus on it. I was like, I'm going to focus on my career, and that only lasted so long. And then getting into, I guess, getting laid off and then getting a lower job, and then finally getting a job where I was going to leave a company. And I guess this is the only way that I can get ahead. Although other people get ahead, it seems, so easily at this company. But for me, I had to get another job to get ahead. So, and I didn't even think they were actually going to offer me anything to stay. I thought it was over and done with. So I accepted the other job, and it was like, you know, it was done. But I ended up staying, and of course, you know, I was excited about, okay, now I'm finally, because I had taken a step back because I was laid off, and I just took a job because I needed a job. And I was like, okay, I'm back to where I was at. I'm still not any further ahead than I've been in, you know, at the time, maybe 6 years or something. And now it's been like over 10, where I'm pretty much at the same, I've been at the same level, at the same point career-wise. I haven't moved ahead. I haven't really done anything. Not that I haven't done anything, because I went into that job and I did, you know, put everything into it. And what I mean is I haven't like done anything like advanced and furthered my career is what I mean. Even though I put everything into that job and was came up with all these ideas of all these things we can do and whatever. And then I end up, I won't go into specifics, but then I end up getting totally fucked over. And not just in what has recently happened, which essentially my job was kind of stolen. It's like my job was stolen from under me. It would be like if you're doing a job, right? And your responsibilities are X. And then somehow for you to do those responsibilities, you need people to come to you to do them. And those people stop coming to you and somebody else starts doing them. So that happened. Before that, a bunch of other things had happened where, things that I was supposed to do that I got fucked over on. And it's just like, I can't believe how, you know, I know how corporations are. I know it's just, this is business and it is what it is. And that's how I look at it. But the way people fuck you over, man, when it comes to their careers and getting ahead and just whatever, people are just, now, it's not a lot of people, and we'll get into this kind of in what we're going to discuss, because we're going to discuss percentages and things based on how many people are in the country, based on actually how many people do certain things. So, you know, how many people are actually like this? A lot of people, but percentage wise in the country, probably a small amount. But there are people that will do whatever just to get ahead or to fuck you over, or some people even just get off on fucking other people over, or just straight up fake, or straight up liars, or they'll do anything to advance their career. Like, they have to get promoted every couple years, and they'll do whatever they have to do it. And if that means fucking somebody over, or taking credit for somebody's work or whatever, I believe they'll do it. Now, me, the only reason I'm even where I'm at now is because, and I'm not trying to be arrogant, is just intelligence and hard work. That's it. Because I don't fuck people over. I don't play that political game. And I don't kiss people's asses. And yes, I can play the political game if I have to. And I don't know if I could do it anymore. I could, you know, but I'm also an emotional person. And for me to play that game, it's just like, I don't want to play that bullshit political game. I don't want to sit there and fucking, because somebody happened to get ahead. And, you know, just because they have a higher position does not mean that they are smarter than you, that they worked harder than you, or they even accomplished more than you. Because a lot of times it's based on who you know. And it might be partially, yes, they know what they're doing, but it's also about whose ass they kissed and who they knew and who they fucked over and took credit for, you know. So there's that as well. And the whole hierarchy of corporations where because you have a fucking title that somehow people should treat you differently is a bunch of bullshit to me. I think that now what I'm saying is not that you should treat that person less. I'm saying that you should treat everybody else just as good. If you're going to treat somebody that well because they're a vice president or a CEO or a CFO or whatever, you should treat everybody else the same way. You shouldn't give, treat them less because they're in a lower position and feed into this bullshit hierarchy of, well, I'm, you know, it's ego and it's I'm better than you or I make more money than you. So that somehow increases my value as a human. And you know what? It doesn't. It doesn't mean shit. You know, probably 99% of the people that work for the company don't know half the shit that I know. Not when it comes to the company and work. That's not what I mean. I mean, the stuff I talk about on the radio and things like that. Now, that doesn't make me any better than them neither, but it's like everybody has their own thing and their own value. Just being a person, a human, every human has value. And to base your self-worth off of where you are in a company or how much you make is what a lot of people do. And I think they're brainwashed to do that. And sometimes I even fall into that trap. And it's sad and unfortunate. But, the things that people have done to me that are in higher positions, and they can get away with it because they're in higher positions, right? So I couldn't get away with it because I'm not in as high a position, but I wouldn't do the shit that they do. But because they're in a high position, they know they can get away with it and they take advantage of that and then treat people like shit. And it's fucked up. It's like that doesn't make you a better person or successful or you're successful because, oh, well, I'm at this level of my job, even though I treat people like shit. Well, what kind of success is that as a person? I mean, to me, none. You're a piece of fucking shit and you should know it. So anyway, I guess that's my venting. I'm not going to go into any more specifics regarding that, but it's just a fucked up situation of people taking advantage of what they can take advantage of, and they know they can take advantage of it, and the fakeness of certain people that you can, you know, those people that you can tell, I mean, they're so fucking fake, it's not even funny. And it's just sometimes it's even sickening when people are that fake, you know. That's the one thing about me that, you know, I love about myself. And I've never actually said that, but I guess I should. That I'm a genuine person. I'm not going to sit there and lie to somebody or fake how I feel or my emotions or whatever. If I'm sitting there talking to somebody and having an honest conversation about something that's going on, I'm going to be honest about it. I can't not, because the way I would feel, for one, and I'm a genuine person. What I say is what I feel, is what I believe, is what is how it is. And that's something that, you know, maybe it's because I'm a quote unquote, I would call myself a street person. I wouldn't call myself a ghetto person because I'm not. I didn't grow up in a ghetto, and, you know, I wasn't ghetto poor neither. But I would call myself a street person. I've been in probably, I tried to count them once, like at least 30 altercations. Now, that could have been just one punch, whether it was me getting punched or them. And that's not counting the times my father hit me. And once I was about to hit him back, but I was still like, you know, I was 17 and I probably weighed like 130 or 40 pounds and I was 5'11". So he was a lot bigger than me. So I don't know how that would have worked out in the end. But when it comes down to it, it's like a lot of people. And I guess this is a general statement, and in some ways it's not true, but a lot of people that are street people that have a code, I guess I'd say, because I don't want to just say street people because a lot of them are fucking lying crooks too. So I'd say people that have like a code, I guess, about, you know, not doing certain things or doing certain things. Like, I don't lie. I don't, you know, in general, I mean, if like the police or something, but I wouldn't lie to the police. I just wouldn't answer their questions because I know better. But, you know, in general, I would. Something like that. But I wouldn't lie to my friends or to people I care about, or when I was a kid, I would lie, you know, maybe to my parents. I don't know that I really did because I didn't have to, but even, you know, people at work or whatever, if I didn't want to talk about something, I just wouldn't talk about it. I'd say, I don't want to talk about it. But I wouldn't sit there and have a personal conversation with somebody and lie about it. I just have a code of honesty and being trustworthy as well. Like, I don't fuck people over. I don't. So I look at these people who probably think, you know, they probably look at me as some punk still. They probably do. And I don't fucking care. Fine. You know, there's something, you know, the way I grew up and whatever, that you probably see that. Some people probably see that. And that's fine. Whatever. But I have more respect for myself than I have for you pieces of shit that go out there and lie and fuck people over and then act like you're a good person because, you know, you've never been in any trouble or you've never gotten in a fight or you've, you know, shit like that. So fuck them. Anyway, we'll get to our topic for tonight, which that kind of relates to in that the percentages, I mean, you know, how many percentages, or what percentage of Americans are actually bad people? That's something that's really hard to know. I mean, I think in general, because you got to look at how you define bad people. So I would consider some of the people I'm talking about bad people, but they're not going to kill anybody. So they're not violent people. So they're not bad in that sense, or they're not a danger, I guess, to society. Although I think they're not bad for society, but I guess that would be bad for what they're doing. What they're doing is bad and is wrong. So I guess it depends on how you want to look at it. But I wouldn't consider them like evil, you know, like the sick people that you got to worry about robbing your house or trying to kill you, or which is a very small percentage of the population. And that's one of the things out of many that you see on TV that they try to present a certain view of things and a certain they present a false narrative of the world. Like, if you're looking at the world through the eyes of government media, not government media itself, but just what they're putting on, because they know that they're putting on bullshit. You watch an episode of the news, everybody's getting killed. Everybody's doing drugs and getting arrested for it. Everybody's raping people, you know, gangbanging, whatever. And you look at, sorry, I'm trying to eat candy, which is bad. I shouldn't be. But they're trying to show you that America is scary and it's evil and it's bad. And you need the government and you need the police. And there's terrorists and there's this and there's that. And, you know, you look at their top stories and some people would say, well, that's for ratings. But is it, though? One of the things that I've always said is that it's not always what you or how you cover something. It's also what you cover. Because you could cover something in a way that manipulates it. That's true. But if you leave things out, or instead of leaving things out, you choose to cover them, you're showing people a certain view. And if you do it on a regular basis, if that's what you're doing every night, more and more people are going to start to believe that. So people in general, and again, this is hard to pinpoint. Is this the majority? Is this whatever? But there's a certain, so I'll say it like this. There's a certain amount of people that will hear 5 to 10 stories of something happening. Now, that could be over a year. And they, based off those 5 to 10 stories, will automatically get a, or have a view that represents the reality of everyday life. Now, there's also a difference between you have local news and you have national news. And you have national news that's on local news. So meaning that, you know, your local news covers national stories as well, right? Like, they'll usually have them, unless they're really, really big, they'll usually have them towards the end. But sometimes they'll have them in the beginning if they're a pretty big story. Otherwise, they'll have, you know, their top local story, which is always negative. When have you ever seen a story on the news be a positive story? And part of that, I guess, is ratings. And they believe that, well, if we do top, you know, if our top stories are positive stories, who cares about that? People want murders and cops arresting people and shit like that. But there's other things that happen that are, I think, newsworthy that need to be covered. There's people's whose rights get abused on a daily basis. Police beat them up. Police harass them. There's all of these incidences of people's freedoms being violated, and they don't give a fuck. They don't. I sent them like my story when I was, you know, thrown around, had huge bruises all over me, sent the pictures and everything, and nobody cared. Not even the small newspapers gave a fuck. So the point being is that, yes, part of it may be ratings, but there's also a lot, plenty of stories like that, which to me, that's a top story. How is that not newsworthy? And at the same time, how is it not, you know, entertaining? Because I know they want to be entertaining as well. Although the news shouldn't be about entertainment. I'm sorry. Unless I guess it's entertainment news. But the news is supposed to be objective, which we know they're not. If we're talking about newscasts or newspapers, at least besides any editorial pages, not things like, you know, the shows that are opinion based, like, you know, my show or a show like mine that was on TV where they talked about facts, but they gave you their opinion on those facts. So, and you also have, so you have newspapers, you have radio, and you have TV, I think are the major ways that people get their news. And I don't think, I was going to say magazines, but I don't think people really get news from magazines. I guess there's some, like I get an NRA magazine and there's some news in there that I've gotten before about the government going after gun manufacturers or something like that, or a new gun bill or something along those lines. It's like things like that you don't hear about. Why don't we hear about bills where the government is going after things that they shouldn't, or the government is taking away more freedom? You might hear about that occasionally, but usually you don't. So, first of all, to put things in perspective, there are 321 million people in the United States. This is the estimated population as of July 1st, 2015 from the CDC. Not the CDC, sorry, the census. So there's my source. I would consider that a reliable source for population. 163 million are male. And then I didn't do the math, obviously, because 58.8 are female. And then the rest are male. But let me, I should be able to do that in my head, right? If about a hundred, about 321, actually, you know what? I have the math on this page. Sorry. So there we go. 321,418,820 is the exact, estimation. You would figure, being that it's an estimation, they'd like round it off, but they really don't, because it's 321,418,820. So 158,138,059 are male, and 163,280,761 are female. And only 6.2% are under age 5, which is about 19 million. And only 73 million are under age 18. I wish I had like teenagers, because I would count them in most of this. So 56% are 18 to 64, and 14.9% are 65 and over. So if we take out people under age 5 and under age 18, although, again, I'd like to probably start at like 15 or 16, but that's fine. You're talking about 227,885,943, which we'll round that off to 228 million. That's a lot of people. And I don't know the breakdown of by that, how much is female and how much is male. But if I apply the same percentages, we could figure that out, you know, a 49.2 and 50.8, although that might not be the same percentages at those age ranges. That would just be an estimate. So let's do that just for the hell of it. And it's almost 50%. So because we don't have an exact estimate on the age ranges of male and female, but we do as a whole, if we say 50%, that's 116 million men and 116 million women. So that's what we'll say for the purposes of what we're doing. So that's a lot of people, both men and women. Now, the reason why I bring this up, and I'm going to start kind of at one thing at a time when I go through population and then how it relates to the things that I want to talk about, that nobody factors in, for the most part. And I never want to say nobody, because I don't know. People could have factored it in something in a newscast before. But in general, what I have seen, and if you disagree, you know, call in or send me an email or something. For those who are, if you're too shy to call in or you don't want to call in, you can send a Skype message to, or there's also a chat room. If you're on Spreaker, if you're listening via Spreaker, there's a chat room. It's kind of to the side of me, so I might not see it right away, but I will answer your question on the air, or type something during the break just to make sure you heard it. But you can also email me at nonpartisanlibertyforall@gmail.com, and all that information is at our website, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com, or just send a Skype message if you want. So remember that I'm always open for questions or calls or whatever, Skype calls or any forms of communication that you would like, even Facebook or Twitter. Twitter kind of sucks, though, because you only get a certain amount of words unless you send a direct message. Not that Twitter sucks in general, although Twitter's for people, if it feels like, with a quick attention span. Like, you get the short messages coming at you, and I'm not a big fan of Twitter. It's fine. I'm on there, but that's more to promote the show. And if you like it, you know, that's fine. I understand. But it is something that is relates to our culture in a negative way. It's like everybody's ADD and shit, and they can't read an article. So, or they can't listen to a two-hour radio show. Or that's why I'm going to, as I've been mentioning, and I still haven't started it yet, but I was waiting to get my hair cut, to be honest. And I just got it cut. And now my fiance isn't going to be here this weekend. So that sucks. I'm going to have to get one of my, hopefully my friend will help me with it, with the camera. And it should be pretty quick because I think I can do it in, you know, one shot, meaning, you know, you might have to do a couple takes, but that I won't have to really edit it. So it will be my first, I guess, YouTube video that was made specifically for YouTube. I did a speech that I put up there, but I haven't actually made a video for YouTube yet. So basically, again, as I talked about, it kind of covers all my bases. I have articles that I write, although I haven't been writing enough. I have the radio show if you like listening to radio. And then I'll have YouTube videos that will kind of summarize what I do on the radio show. I want to do it where they all relate to the same thing. And that's what I got to focus on, is that if I'm doing this show, and this show is based on an article I started writing and didn't finish, but I want to be able to, you know, do this show, finish the article, and then talk about it on YouTube in a 5 to 10 minute video. So based on what is best for you, if you don't have a lot of time and just want to watch a quick YouTube video, you can watch it on YouTube. If you want to listen to the whole radio show, you can do that. And you can always pause and come back. And if you want to read an article because you like to read, and it gets more into the details, or the difference in an article would be that it's more thought-provoking because I can think more about it and plan it out, as opposed to, yes, I plan out the show with an outline, but I don't map out everything I'm going to say, because then it would just sound stupid, and I don't believe that's how you do radio. And I don't think most people that do radio do that either. It's a more off the cuff thing. Yes, you plan out, most people, I believe, plan out what they're going to talk about. But you also, if you get calls and messages and stuff like that, which I haven't got a lot of recently, but you have to be able to react to that as well. So it's constantly a changing thing that you need to adapt to. Whereas, you know, an article, you can just sit and plan it out. And same with a YouTube video. You could write exactly what you're going to say as well. But it's a lot shorter. So anyway, so we'll say, for the purposes of what we're doing, we'll just even it off. So 116 million would bring us to, my math's right on that, right? No, it would be 106 million. Yeah, no, I'm off by four. How am I off by four? No, I'm off by six. So, because I'm retarded, it would be 112, right? No, that would be 4. 130, no. Would it be 113.5? I don't know where I got 116 from. I think I was thinking of some multiplication. Oh, no, 114. Duh. So 114. Just in case we need to refer to females and males. And then I broke down, I have race, which I had to kind of make it fit, because technically in the census, they don't, Hispanic is not a race, but to some people it is. So I did it where if you consider yourself Hispanic of any race. So there's white Hispanics and black Hispanics, which makes sense because, like, if you're Dominican, some of them, not all Dominicans, I know a lot of Dominicans that are light-skinned, but there's Dominicans that – and the reason I say Dominicans because I see the most when it comes to Hispanics that are dark, the most I see are Dominican. But there's other races of Hispanics or Hispanics from other countries that are dark as well. So there's Hispanics that are considered black and that are considered white, but I didn't do that. I just put it all to Hispanic. So if you're Hispanic of any race, you're considered Hispanic, and as far as this conversation goes. And then somehow it didn't balance. It was off by like 2%, so I put the rest to other. So I have 0.5 other. But the what I came up with is 60.6% white, 13.3 black, 1.2 Native American or Native Alaskan. I guess they group them together. Then Native Islander, 0.2 Hispanic of any race, 17.6. That seems low. And then Asian, 5.6. Yeah, that does seem low. I don't know. So, and maybe that's, you know, they say what? There's 13 million illegals or something like that, or some estimates are even 20 million. So if that was the case, then that percentage would go way up. So, but not all illegals are Hispanic neither, but I think they were saying that there was a certain, when they were talking about the amount of Mexican illegals, that it was really high, over like 15 million or something, possibly. So who knows, but that would put that number higher. It's really irrelevant for the conversation. And really, race doesn't really come into the majority of what I'm going to talk about regarding the media. It will a little, but I just took those numbers for future reference if I ever needed to look at the population split by race. And then I also have other documents from the CDC that look at causes of death and the percentages and things like that. So the point is that we can look at causes of death based on the population, and that's going to come up in a bunch of things that I'm going to talk about, where people think that something that happens all the time really does not, because it's not put in perspective. So there's so many things that are not put in perspective. So that's really what we're going to focus on tonight. And I'm going to take a brief break and play some interesting clips. So be sure to listen in to those. And we'll probably go to at least 9:30 tonight. You know, I always schedule the show for 2 hours, but I've been going over. Originally, I did a 3-hour show. That's why. And I can't seem to cram it into 2 hours. Occasionally I can, but for the most part, I usually don't. So we'll see how it goes. But if we need more time, then I'll go till 9:30 Pacific time. So, but we'll be right back after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com.
To whom does your life belong? Who owns you? Most people instinctively answer, "I own myself." But most people don't actually believe that. What does it mean to own something? It means that you and you alone have the right to decide what is done with that thing. What is yours, you can use, you can trade, you can give away, you can destroy. So what does it mean to say you own yourself? It means that you and you alone have the right to decide what is done with your body and your mind, with your time and your energy. If someone else had the right to decide what is done with your body and your mind, your time and your energy, then he would be your owner and you would be his slave. So, are you anyone's slave? Do you pay taxes? Do you feel obligated to obey whatever the politicians decide to call law? Do you imagine that someone else has the right to control you, to rule you? Do you vote? In every political election, you are asked to decide who you want owning you, but owning yourself is never one of the options offered. The only choice you are given is the choice of which politicians will coerce and control you by way of so-called regulation and legislation, and confiscate what you produce by way of taxation. Whoever wins, you will be extorted and dominated. When you vote, whether you win or not, you are accepting that someone else has the right to rule you. You are conceding the state's authority over you. You are agreeing that you are going to be someone's slave, with the only question being which political master will own you. If you believe that you have an obligation to pay taxes, if you concede that it is up to someone else to decide how much of your earnings they will let you keep, then you are their slave. If you own yourself, you don't need the permission of anyone. Any individual, any group, any collective, any country, any legislature, to run your own life, make your own choices, and keep the fruits of your own labor. As long as the politicians see you voting, petitioning, protesting, and campaigning, begging for tax cuts, whining for different legislation, as long as they see you timidly obeying whatever commands they issue while begging them to change their so-called laws, then they know that they own you in mind and body. Writing or calling your congressman merely tells him that you still think he's important, that you still view him and his fellow parasites as authority, and that you still think it's his choice whether to let you be free or not. As long as you play their games and legitimize their system, obeying their so-called laws and paying their so-called taxes, acting as if they are your rightful lords and masters, the tyrants know they have nothing to fear. The slave master doesn't mind his slaves pitifully begging for mercy, as long as they keep obeying and keep producing wealth for the master to steal. Those in power aren't worried about elections or petitions. What they do fear is that one day their victims will realize the truth, will stop believing in the divine right of politicians, will stop calling liars and crooks lawmakers, will stop calling the tyrants, mercenaries, law enforcers, will stop believing that anyone has the right to rule them, will stop imagining authority where there is none, will realize that they own themselves, and will stop bowing to the parasitical, anti-human beast called government. If you own your time and effort, and the fruits of your labor, then stop asking nicely to be allowed to keep it. If you own yourself, then stop asking nicely for legislative permission to run your own life. If you actually believe in unalienable rights, in individual liberty, in freedom, then stop asking nicely for the sociopathic parasites to let you be free. For humanity to be free, people need to stop thinking, talking, and acting like slaves. Stop bowing to megalomaniacs. Stop paying tribute to sociopaths. Stop obeying political parasites. If you truly understand that you own yourself, then start acting like it.
Hey, Larkin Rose here. One of the first things that people are concerned about when they start thinking about a society without a ruling class is, well, what happens to the nasty people? Whether you're talking about people who are just kind of negligent or inconsiderate, play their music too loud at night or leave their trash lying around the woods or whatever it is, all the way up to people who run around attacking and murdering people. So people say, well, what would happen to them? What would we do about that? Some people even go so far as to say, if not for government, there would be nothing to stop people from committing murder and doing whatever other nasty stuff. And it's funny because when somebody says that, there would be no consequences. They could do whatever they wanted and nobody would stop them. The person saying that is implying that he isn't going to do anything. If there's someone running around attacking and murdering innocent people, the guy who said nothing will happen to them, obviously he's not going to do anything or something would happen to them. But not only is he demonstrating his own cowardice when he said there would be nothing to stop murderers, he's also projecting his own immaturity and irresponsibility onto the rest of the world, because he's also saying the other 7 billion people wouldn't do anything about it, which obviously isn't true. I would. Wouldn't you? If somebody was running around murdering your neighbors, would you just go, well, there aren't politicians and there's nobody with a badge and we don't have tax collectors and bureaucrats, so, oh, well, I guess they're just out of luck. They're going to get murdered. And would you not even protect yourself if there wasn't government? Obviously, lots and lots of people, all the sane people, would do whatever they could to protect themselves and defend the innocent. So to say nothing would happen is just really bizarre. And it comes from having a mentality basically of a little kid in a classroom where the teacher walks out of the room and the kids are just sitting there. We don't know what to do. No authority is telling us what to do. And Johnny's throwing things at me and there's no teacher to stop him. Ah! Because most people, having been trained into authoritarian mentality, it never occurs to them that they are the ones who should fix anything, who should stop anything. And so when people say, well, what would be done about this and that or the other thing, nasty people doing nasty things, the first thing I ask is, well, what would you do about it? Because people are so into the mentality that there has to be some master plan and some authority who writes down the law of here is what will be done with those people, that people don't think in terms of, well, what would I do about it? Which is why I always ask people, well, what would you do about it? You're a person just as much as me and just as much as the other 7 billion. What would you feel justified in doing if somebody was polluting or playing their music too loud at night or running around murdering people or whatever in between you can think of? Any nasty thing, what would you feel justified in doing about it? Because there's a very basic rule of being a moral human being, which is if it would be wrong for you to do something, don't ask anybody else to do it. And the rule is so simple, so self-evident and obvious that most people will go, well, duh, of course. Trouble is, nobody in the world who believes in government abides by that rule. Nobody. I don't care if you're a constitutionalist, Democrat, Republican, fascist, communist, anything, any kind of statist. There is nobody who believes in government who abides by the most basic rule of morality, which is if it's wrong for you to do something, don't ask somebody else to do it. Because every single candidate, every party, every government always does things that the voters know they themselves have no right to do. And to say something like, well, I'm voting for the guy who's going to tax you less. Well, do you have the right to rob me a little bit less than the other guy? No, you don't. So telling me that, well, somebody was going to rob you more, but I voted for the guy to rob you a little bit less, you are still violating the basic rule of being a human being. If it's wrong for you, don't ask somebody else to do it. That's kind of the second basic rule, the first one being the non-aggression principle. And they actually go together quite well. But when people are in the mindset that there's going to be some major centralized plan to deal with whatever, polluters or people who play their music too loud or murderers or whatever else, they have to get out of that mindset. They have to start to think that maybe they are among the people who have to do something about it. So instead of setting, what will be done about such and such? Well, what will you do about it? What should I do about it? And this doesn't magically make all the problems go away, but the actual practical challenge of dealing with most disputes is trivial compared to the challenge of getting people to think like responsible adults, where they start to think, well, maybe it's up to me. And a while back, I did little events called Escaping the Myth. And one of the little mental exercises I did with these little groups of people is, imagine we're on an island, and we're it. There's no government, there's no authority, there's nobody with a badge. And one of us is running around stealing stuff from other people. He's not killing anybody, but he's stealing stuff. What are we going to do about it? We normal people. There's not a legislature, there's not 911 to call, there's nobody with a badge. It's just people. And so with that specific example, I would ask people, so what do we do? And just off the top of their heads, everybody comes up with solutions that are way better than what government ever does. First of all, every government solution is, all right, step one, I get to rob everybody. That's the government solution. Well, we're going to tax everybody so we have the resources to stop that other robber. Well, in the island scenario, nobody is stupid enough or insane enough to start with that, to say, well, let's see, so somebody's stealing our stuff. Okay, first, I get to rob all of you so that I have the resources to protect you from him. Nobody is that insane. Everybody is insane enough to believe that who believes in government. And I did for many years. I was stupid enough to actually think that it was rational and moral to advocate mass extortion in order to protect people. And that's just stupid. So I just believed something insanely stupid for a very long time. Most of the world still believes that. But in a setting where people are put on the spot and they're responsible for what happens, they don't do that. They don't say, well, I get to boss everybody around and take their money. Nobody does that. So to me, the challenge is not even coming up with specific solutions to every imaginable dispute or problem, which I don't pretend to know how everything's going to turn out. And I don't intend to be emperor of anarchy. I'm not going to be in charge of the world. But getting people to the mindset where it's up to them, where there's just people, we're it. No legislatures, no people with badges, no authority. We're just people. Suddenly people are way better at solving problems and making things work. One good example is when there's a disaster. Unfortunately, sometimes it takes a horrendous event to bring out the best in people. And it brings out the worst in some people too. But when people say, whoa, my neighbor's house is floating away, I'm not gonna wait for FEMA. I'm not gonna dial 911. I'm gonna jump in a boat and go save him. Because suddenly it's on me. Suddenly I'm the one who has to do something. And when it occurs to people that they're the ones who have to do something, and unfortunately, usually that only happens in a complete disaster area, when it occurs to people and they suddenly take on the responsibility and start to think like adults, their solutions are generally a lot better than any government solutions and ever are. But to get to that mentality, people have to shift from the authoritarian mindset to the mindset of a self-owning individual who realizes there is nothing above me. There is no magic unicorn who's going to come to save the day, who's going to come save me from polluters or somebody playing their music too loud or murderers or whatever it is. It's just us. And if we realize that, then first of all, people would stop asking me, well, without a government, how would this be handled? As if I'm going to be in charge. I don't freaking know. What would you do about it? I can tell you what I would do about it. I could tell you what I might suggest, what I might predict, but who cares? I'm one of 7 billion people. I'm not going to be in charge any more than you are. So it's really a mental exercise that people have to think over in their own heads with their own moral codes instead of waiting for some outside answer. And it's why I don't usually get into those discussions of, well, here's my plan for how to deal with this and that and the other thing, because my plan doesn't matter. My plan will not be the best plan for any problem you can come up with. There will be a million people with better plans than whatever I could come up with. So don't ask me to describe how you are going to fix problems. I don't freaking know. And you can see the mind shift in people when they grasp that they own themselves and they suddenly realize, oh, okay, well, yeah, there are things we can do to settle disputes, to protect ourselves from attackers, to do this or that or the other thing. But the first step is just grow up. Stop thinking it's somebody else's business to make the world work. Well, how will the poor be cared for? I don't know. What are you going to do? Well, how will we be protected from this? I don't know. What are you going to do about it? And it is inconvenient. It's inconvenient to be a free person where you can't just be a kid in a classroom whining to the teacher to save the day and fix everything and make everything work, where you actually have to be a responsible adult. And that's one of the reasons, one of the main reasons why people like the belief in authority, because then they can live with the lie that all they have to do is obey and do as they're told and everything will be okay. First of all, no, it won't be okay. Second of all, you're not even being a human being. You just threw your free will out the window and became somebody's slave in the hopes that that would help humanity. It doesn't help humanity for you to be a slave. It doesn't help humanity for everybody else to be a slave. It does help humanity for you to start thinking as an adult, responsible human being who owns himself and who accepts that it is your responsibility to figure out how to make the world work. Hey, Larkin Rose here. Never ceases to amaze me how much emotionalistic mush outranks the most basic logic when it comes to political discourse. I'll use the example here of gun registration. Whenever there's a crime or a mass shooting or something, there's always people out there pushing. We need reasonable measures and reasonable restrictions. At least registration. At least require registration. It'll take the most basic logic in the world and all of about 2 minutes to show why that is just utterly stupid. Why the people promoting that are either amazingly dense or are lying intentionally. And I would put it to the voters who support it to just be dense and the politicians pushing it to be total liars and crooks. Here's why. First of all, what does gun registration mean? It means the people in power have a list of people and the guns that they've registered. So you have a gun with a serial number and you can look it up and say, oh, Bob owns that particular rifle, whatever it is. That's all gun registration does. It gives them a list of owners and firearms that have been registered. Of course, it doesn't give them a list of firearms that are purchased illegally and not registered. It only gives them a list of registered firearms. Okay, so let's say we have that. Oh, goody, now we're all safer and it's for the children and yada, yada, yada. What good did that do? And oddly, I don't even hear, like, Second Amendment advocates pointing this out. It's so basic and so obvious, and I don't even hear it from them. Okay, so we have gun registration. What good did it do? Let's consider a scenario. A guy takes a gun, and he goes to a liquor store, and he holds up the place, and he steals the money. Maybe he even shoots the owner and runs away. But luckily, he did it with a registered firearm. Guess what? It doesn't do any good. Because when the investigators get there, there's a dead guy with some bullets in him. They don't know what gun was used. Sometimes in a traffic accident, somebody will say, oh, I got the license plate number of the car driving away. Nobody at any shooting has ever said, oh, I got the serial number off the gun that the criminal was holding. Nobody has ever, ever done that. Which means in this scenario, gun registration is absolutely useless in the investigation. And to those who watch too much of Hollywood's version of investigation, you can't look at a bullet and magically analyze it and know what gun it came from. To do the bullet analysis to see if they match, you have to have the gun and shoot another bullet out of it to see if the grooves the barrel leaves match. You have to have the gun. If the guy comes in, commits a crime, and runs away with the gun, gun registration doesn't do the slightest bit of good. None. Zero. Scenario number two, the mass shootings, because that's when you hear about, we need gun registration to stop these mass shootings. Think about these things for a minute, people. How would that help? When somebody's going to go on a shooting rampage for whatever messed up reason in their head, they think that's a good idea, they're not intending to get away with it. They don't think, oh, nobody's going to notice if I run into a school and shoot 30 people. They know they're going to get noticed. They know they're going to get caught. Most of them plan on dying and either kill themselves or do suicide by cop or die in a hail of gunfire. So that happens. Well, luckily, the gun was registered so that we can go and find the dead guy who just had a shootout and now he's dead and the gun lying next to him. We can look up the gun and see that it was his. What good did that do? You couldn't figure out he was the shooter by the fact that he was standing there shooting people? You had to go look at the list and say, yep, that's his gun. Of what use is that information after he's done it? And it's not a deterrent factor because he didn't intend to get away with it. He intended to die, and he did. So the fact that after the fact you can look it up and say, oh, well, yeah, that was his gun. Whoopee-doo. Way to go, Sherlock. In what way did that help anything? So another scenario in which gun registration is completely useless. There's basically one scenario in which gun registration would do any good, which is scenario number one, slightly modified. The guy walks into a liquor store, says, give me all your money. The guy hands over the money. He shoots the owner, puts his gun on the counter, and runs away. And the investigators show up and say, oh, he was nice enough to leave us his gun. And he was nice enough to register it ahead of time, buy it legally and register it and tell us he had it, and then commit a crime and leave his gun there. Now, this would also apply if he drops it
or in one way or another, leaves the gun behind. Because then you can look it up and say, hey, this is Bob's. That doesn't even prove that Bob did it. It proves that he owned it. If somebody else stole it, then Bob gets in trouble for something he didn't even do. But that's the only scenario in which it does any good, because for gun registration, to look up one, you have to have the other one. To look up the gun, you have to have the person. To look up the person, you have to have the gun. Generally speaking, when somebody commits a crime, they take their gun with them when they leave, which means registration is completely pointless. And so there are tons of voters out there. We need reasonable registration. Those people are just stupid. They just haven't thought it out enough to realize that wouldn't do the slightest bit of good. In the vast majority of crimes, it would do absolutely nothing, even if you had every firearm registered. The politicians aren't dumb enough to think it's going to reduce crime, which means they're just liars and crooks. So why do they want it so bad? They know, they easily understand this basic logic, which shows that this is not going to help investigate or prevent crimes. So why do they want it? Well, there's another thing lists are good for, is if you want to take people's guns, as we're now seeing in Connecticut. That's why they want it. It's extreme to think that they want gun registration so they know who has guns so they can come and take them. No, it's profoundly idiotic to think they want it for any other reason, because it doesn't serve any other purpose. Except on the rare occasion that some criminal is dumb enough to commit a crime and leave his gun there. Register the gun, commit a crime, leave the gun there and run and go home where they can find him by looking him up in the gun registration lists. So it's so sad, and I don't even hear this discussion, even from Second Amendment advocates. You know, every once in a while you'll get bits and pieces of it, but mostly it's like, this will reduce crime. No, it'll increase crime. And nobody ever points out, it just logically, it is completely impossible for gun registration to have any positive effect in the vast majority of crimes, including 100% of shooting sprees. Because after the fact, finding out that the guy who did a shooting spree owns the gun lying next to him doesn't do any good. Whoopie-doo. Well, now we're not going to sell him another gun. Huh. Doesn't really matter. Now it's a little too late. So it's just, it's sad that you get these massive national debates which skip, you know, it only takes 2 minutes of thinking about to realize, wait, that logically cannot possibly help in the vast majority of crimes. And yet this emotionalistic garbage has well-intentioned people out there. At least we need a database and blah, and they just don't think it through. So, and that's just one example of a whole bunch of how the fear-mongering and the control freak attempts to grab more power and restrict liberty. People just, you know, they get emotional when something really horrible happens. We have to do something for the children. Okay, if you're going to do something for the children, can you take a time out for 1 minute? See if you can get your brain working long enough to realize that when the politicians say, we have to do something, always they mean, give us more power and you get less freedom. Always. When they say we have to do something, that is absolutely always what they mean. And most of the time, it takes about 8 seconds of thought to realize that won't actually solve the problem. It'll just make a new, even worse problem.
Promoting the ideas of true freedom and liberty, Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back here on this Tuesday live. So if you want to call in, you can call in at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-6664. Or you can call us via Skype. Username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And if you forget any of that, you can go to nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. You can also email us from the email address there, or go to the chat room on Spreaker. So if you just go to Spreaker/user is me. If you go to Spreaker and search for the show, or you go to nonpartisanlibertyforall.com and just click on it, or you're already there, You can go to the chat room there and ask a question or make a comment, and I will respond to that on the air. So one of the clips that I was playing had to do with gun violence, and I did actually download this document. It's like fucking 122 pages. I looked at death rates, and I put them in a spreadsheet. I didn't get to guns because guns is not even in the top 15. And in my spreadsheet, I only got to the top 10. Or is that nine? I guess I only got to nine. The ninth being something I can't even pronounce. Nephrotic syndrome and nephrosis. I don't know. I'm horrible at pronouncing shit like that. So, and that is 1.83% of the deaths. So when we look at deaths, I'm like saying that like retarded deaths. It's just, I don't know. I think it's the word when you put an S on death. Anyway, there were, I think these are 2014 statistics, either 14 or 15. There were about 2.6 million people that had died. Now, 50% of those, actually 51.52, sorry, I was including chronic respiratory disease. 45% of those are heart disease and cancer, first of all. You have about 614,000 from heart disease, 591 from cancer. The ninth one was 48,000, the one I just mentioned that I couldn't pronounce. So anything under that is less than 48,000. Now, from what I understand, if you don't count suicides, the highest rate of gun deaths in the past couple years, and I heard Obama even say 8,000, and I thought that was low because I heard a higher number. But I know if you include like suicides, it's like 30,000. Now, I'm going to argue, of course, that you cannot include suicides because of the simple fact that there are so many ways to kill yourself, and if you want to kill yourself, it's not that hard. So, plus, going back to the idea of self-ownership, and it depends on why the people had killed themselves, because even though you own yourself, you could be mentally ill, you could be depressed, or well, I guess that would fall under mentally ill. I don't know how I feel about that. I do believe it is your right to kill yourself. Now, what happens, and I could do a whole show on this, which I should, on mental illness, especially since I have somebody mentally ill in the family. What happens when somebody you consider mentally ill wants to kill themselves, and what's the definition of mentally ill? Because you could want to kill yourself because you have a disease that's going to eventually kill you, and you don't want to go through the pain and agony of that disease. And the fact that assisted suicides have to, you have to follow all this stuff. And I don't know if it's legal in any states. I think a couple, I know it was. And I know Dr. Kevorkian had been arrested in a couple places where he set it up where he didn't actually do it. The person had to like press a button or something like that. So he was smart enough to get around the laws. But I believe in certain places it was legal. Now, it's your body. You can do what you want with it. But if you're in a state of depression or something like that, I do believe friends and family members have the right to intervene. Now, when it comes to the government, I don't believe the government has the right to intervene. Because I don't believe they should exist. So if they didn't exist, then obviously it would have to be friends and family or security or something like that, that would, and we're talking in cases where someone is trying to use a gun. So you have the, I guess, potential of them trying to shoot you, which is unlikely, but it could accidentally go off or something like that. So, and what usually happens when police get called, and this has happened over and over again, is they end up killing the person. If a person has a gun and is threatening to kill themselves, if you want them to die, call the police, because the police will usually shoot them. And I'm not exaggerating. I have tons of backup for this to show occasions where that's what the police did. Anyway, I don't want to get into a whole discussion about suicides and your right to commit suicide, because that's just going to take up a whole bunch of time, and that's not what our focus is tonight. But that may be something we talk about on another show or at another time. So I don't believe you can count suicides as gun deaths. I mean, yes, technically it's a death by a gun, but it's self-inflicted and it's not a danger to anybody else, because that's what people that are against guns is about, the danger really to other people for the most part. Now, you do have people whose relatives have committed suicide with a gun, and of course they blame the gun, as opposed to, you know, you can jump off fucking a bridge, or any city has buildings high enough where you can get to the top and jump off of them too. And that's just, there is no surviving that. You're more likely to survive getting shot in the head than jumping off a building or a bridge. Of course, depending on how high the building is. But, I mean, once you get to a certain height, you're not going to live. You're going to just splat. Not a nice way to put it, but that's the facts. So as far as people being murdered by guns, even if we say the number is 10,000 on average over the past couple of years, I'll even say that just to make the pro gun control, ban guns so the government can, you know, won't be scared to come into your house and do whatever they want to you, people, just to make them happy. Now, if we go back, one, to our percentage of population, and two, to our amount of deaths. So, again, I think this is based on 2004. I have them split by men and women. And, of course, as you would think, men are more than women, but not as much as you would think, because it's really pretty close. Men are only about 1%, not even, more die than women. I thought it was, oh, you know what? It's age is what it is that women live so much longer. Because this is not, I didn't break it down by age. I just broke it down by sex. And I was getting to age, which I do have on this document that I downloaded that's 122 pages that I could find there if we get into that. So I don't think that's really the point of what I'm trying to cover, is, you know, whether it was men or women is kind of irrelevant. But I think if you looked at ages, that's what I have heard, that women live longer not that more women die or more men die per year than women. And there's more women in the country. And 1% actually can be a lot, because 1% is almost a million people. Well, actually, no. Not of the 2.6. It's a difference of about 30,000 more. But it makes a difference when you're talking about 321 million. So when you look at the population and you say that men are 49.2% of the population and women are 50.8, that's a difference of 4 million. So there's 4 million more women than men. So that's a lot in terms of people. It's not a lot in terms of percentage. And the reason why this means so much, because people might be like, well, so what? A bunch of people, a lot of people is a lot of people. Yes, but the more people you get, and the United States, I believe, at least the last list I checked, is number 3 in population behind India and China. And Soviet Union used to be more when it was actually the Soviet Union. But since then, it is, I'd have to go back to my list. I don't even think it's number 4. I think it's in the top 10. But India and China, obviously everybody knows China is number 1. And then India, and then the U.S., at least on what I was looking at. Somebody had thought another country was above the U.S. But no matter how you look at it, 321 million, that's a lot of people. And the reason why it matters, the percentage, is because obviously you're going to have a percentage of fucked up people or crazy people or people that would use a gun to just murder people at random or whatever. Every place is going to have that, people like that. There's people, and I think that this is not generally accepted, that there are just people that are crazy. When somebody goes out and kills somebody for no reason, you know, the FBI and all the law enforcement groups, they want to go through what were they reading, what were they watching, what websites were they going to, all this shit. And they want to collect that data because they want to develop profiles. And if you fit that profile, they may just come and visit you. And that's going to be the future, where they're developing more and more profiles. Really, it's meaningless, because you can find people that are into the exact same things. It doesn't mean you're going to be a serial killer. It just, like, you can find people into horror movies and death stuff and blood, and that's the extent of it. But the reason why it means so much is, I think, pretty obvious. You know, the more people that you have, the higher amount of people are going to be crazy, and the more crimes or more violence or more whatever, at least in terms of people. Now, if that's where you look at per capita or percentages. Now, per capita would be an example, like per 100,000. So it's like a measurement similar to percentage. So per 100,000 people, you know, 10 people were killed by ladders falling on their heads. Not that I'm saying that. That's just an example. So if we say 10,000 people were killed by guns in a year as an average, and I believe that's actually even high, but let's say that. So as a percentage of the population, and we'll even take that as a percentage of the population over 18, even though I realize that people under 18, so divided by that. No, that's not right. Because that would be, okay, I know what I did. This, close parentheses, I'm in Excel, divided by the sum of these two numbers. And somehow that didn't work out right neither. Let me make this easier. On air, I'm doing Excel and you can't even see it, so I'm sure that is fun for everybody. Okay, so, oh, I already had the number anyway. I estimated it at 220 million. But really, it's 10,000 divided by 228 million, about. But why is that not? Am I doing something wrong here? And I'm good at Excel, too. Is it because I'm not formatting percentage? Yeah. So, as a percentage of the population, and this is of the population over 18, that is 0.004. Now, as a percentage of the population as a whole, because actually a lot of teenagers, not a lot, but I mean, in that number, I'm sure 5 to 10% are 16, 17. You also have idiots that, you know, get a gun and don't know how to shoot and kill some little girl out playing, which is horrible. And nobody really even talks about shit like that. And I'm not even talking about the racial aspect, you know, if it's, you know, black gangs or something like that. Not that I'm even saying that it is, but in that case, it's 0.003. And then if you want to go to more decimal points, 111. So if we go to the same amount of decimal points, it's 0.003. So that would be, it's not a third of a percent. It's like a 300th of a percent. So that's of the total population. Now, of the people that died, obviously it's going to be higher. So if you take the total people that died divided by, or the 10,000 divided by the total people that died, you would still get, no, that's not right, 0.003. Well, I can't get, oh, because I'm not. Let me convert this shit into fucking percentage. Oh, that's why I converted the other one in percentage. Yeah, because this is 0.004% and 0.003%. Because if I did it just decimal based, it'd be like point, you know, 10 zeros and then a four. So it's like a hundredth of a percent. These are, if you take the amount of people that are killed by guns, not counting suicides, in an actual elevated number, just to make the anti-gun pro-government, only give the government a bunch of guns. You know, even Washington, and I should play this clip from Larkin Rose, at least this part, even Washington, among others, said that the people should be more well-armed than the government. So that's one of those things that's irrelevant, the type of weapon you have, because people would say, well, they had muskets back then, that's why. But no, he said they should be more well-armed than the government. So the fact that whether it's muskets or M16s is irrelevant. His point was they need more power than the government if they have to take it over. But this is 0.38%. So it's not even 1%. It's not even a half of a percent per year. So to take something like guns and to show on the news every time somebody is being shot, especially on local news, a lot of times it will reach national news depending on who is shot. You know, of course, if you're some kid in the ghetto, it's probably not going to make national news. It will just make local news, and it probably won't be the top story. But if you're somebody that lives in the suburbs, it will probably be the top story on at least your local news. Maybe not even your national news in that case. But the point being, and I don't have the numbers here, but the difference between the amount of people that are killed from handguns and rifles is huge. So many more people are killed with handguns. The reason why they want to go after rifles is because it's a lot harder for people to fight against tyranny than if they only had handguns. Because if you really wanted to try to stop gun violence, and banning guns isn't going to do it, but, you know, at least they could say we're going after this gun. Now, if you're somebody who wants to take guns away from everybody, including the police and the government and the military, then at least I have more respect for you because you're consistent. Because what you're saying is it's okay for them to be well-armed, and they're just armed out of their minds. I mean, the amount of guns that the government has and these agencies that you're like, what the fuck do they have an armed agency for? Every agency you can think of either has a department or the whole agency is armed. Now, I don't care if that person has a gun outside of work. In a way, I don't care that that person has their own personal gun if they had it on them while they were working, except for the fact that if they used it while they were on the job, that would be the government using it, and then that's the problem. So I guess when they're off duty, I wouldn't have a problem with them having a gun that they went out and bought themselves and having to be restricted by the same things that everybody else is. Now, I don't believe people should have to be restricted, period. And I think a lot of people think that's fucked up. But to me, that's just, again, brainwashing. I mean, you go back in history, all of these things And it depends. You know what's fucked up is it depends probably who you read. But, you know, some books will probably tell you that, yeah, when, you know, guns were pretty much totally legal, there were all these things that went on and it was bad and whatever. Because the same way a lawyer, you know, can defend a case and skew the evidence and skew the facts and kind of what we're talking about now, you know, you can do the same thing with anything. You can skew the facts so they meet your agenda. Now, I don't want to do that because I believe in what I believe in, not because of these fucking numbers. I could care less. I'm presenting these numbers because they also put things in perspective that people are outraged over things that they shouldn't be, or they should be more outraged over other things that are going on. And I don't really want to tell somebody what they should be outraged over, but right away they've been programmed to be anti-gun. And there's so many other things that kill more people than guns that they're not outraged and against. And I've heard like a bunch of them. So, and I don't want to spend that much more time on guns because I got a whole bunch of other stuff to go over. But the point being is that I don't give a fuck what the amount. I mean, I do because I don't want people to die, but whether 10,000 or 100,000 people were killed with guns, I would still tell you the exact same thing. I would tell you that it is everyone's right to own a gun. It is everyone's right to own whatever the fuck they want to own. And then you get all those what if people. I got some what if today, although I actually then got an intelligent conversation about some things. But I got the what about the roads? I don't know if he said that because he knows everybody says that, because he seemed to be pretty educated in what I was saying, but I don't know. It might have been a joke. But my answer, and I did steal this from Larkin Rose because he has, like I said, a lot of good stuff. And as I had said, I didn't get my ideas from Larkin Rose as far as how I feel about things, but he's able to explain things in such a good way with his analogies and his storytelling ability and his public speaking ability, that I would use or try to use an analogy of his to explain something. But of course, I can't do it as good as him. But, you know, I said, well, it will work, you know, the same way he had talked about the supermarket. And I thought it was a good analogy. He's like, you know, government has nothing to do with food for the most part. Now, I know they partake in farm subsidies and stuff like that, but the supermarket runs without the government. It runs fine. We all have food. Nobody worries about, well, what happens if the government goes away? How are we going to get food? And that was the analogy I used, that, you know, if we're able to seamlessly do this, how would we not be able to build fucking roads? And that actually worked as a reason. So I'm sure I can, you know, think more about it and come up with a maybe a better one, but that's a pretty good one. And they try to catch you off guard, because the difference is, and this is just an aside, when you're talking to statists, and I'm not saying that this person was even a statist, I don't know what their opinion is, although they seem open to a lot of these things and aware of them. But I noticed that what they'll do, because you can't refer directly to a specific country that is a true, if you want to use the word anarchist or whatever, but is a country, I'd rather say a country that's doesn't have rulers. There's no example for us to point to and say, well, how would you do this? And to say, well, this country over here, that's how they are, and they're fine. So there is no country. But what I did say was that every government and every empire has not only fell, but at some point, although there's still a couple that have been around for a while, England seems to, they almost fell to Germany. And but since the last, and I think they fell at some point in like ancient times, but since the last time they fell, they've been Great Britain for quite a long time now. And they've developed an empire and then got rid of a lot, or let, I don't know, they say they let these territories go, or they were forced to let them go or whatever, but I'm not sure what land is controlled by Great Britain right now. I don't think there's a lot. There's a lot that they originally controlled, or that they controlled at some time. But every government has oppressed its quote-unquote citizens, because I still don't know what that is supposed to mean, or people that have lived within its geographical borders. At some point, they have been oppressed by the government, and that's all governments. That's the purpose of government. And this is my theory, and this is my belief that I bring up all the time, is that that is the goal and the purpose of government, to control people and to ultimately get to the point where they control every aspect of your life, along with every thing in it, in its geographical area. Now, different countries take different paths to try to do that. And, you know, different times, I guess, call for different measures. Although the United States doesn't seem to be having much of a problem right now taking more and more control. So with guns, I mean, looking at that, it's not in the top 15, first of all. I have my list here where I think it only went to the top 15. And that's because it's so small, the amount of people that are killed by guns. Yeah, it's not the 15 leading causes of death for 2014. And I already gave you the top 9. 10 is suicide. 11 is septicemia. I've never heard any commercials for that, or people having telethons or trying to fight that. Septicemia. I mean, the way it's spelled is like, it almost starts to spell September. SEPTICEMIA, septicemia, or septicemia. That's probably not how it's pronounced, but, and the next thing I wanted to talk about is drugs. And you look at what's number 12. Well, number 12 in the top 15 is, of course, chronic liver disease and cirrhosis. Now, what percentage of that is cirrhosis? I don't know. But usually chronic liver disease, a high percentage of that, not all of it, is caused by cirrhosis. Now, cirrhosis is a direct cause of alcohol. I don't know if there's, I'm sure there's somebody, but, you know, the percentage of people that have died of cirrhosis that weren't drinkers, I'm sure it's very, very tiny. So then it's hypertension, and 14 is Parkinson's, and 15 is pneumonia due to solids and liquids, or not pneumonia, pneumonitis. I don't know. I'm sorry for the people that are listening to me pronounce, trying to pronounce these fucking things. So it's not even in the top 15 because the amount is very small. And this is whether there's been mass shootings that year or not. It's pretty much stayed, you know, it's not always in the exact same number, but you look at the amount of, I mean, if 23 people die in a mass shooting, now I'm not saying, you know, who cares about those 23 people? Of course, you care if anybody dies. And it doesn't matter how they die. You can't worry about, I've always made this statement before, you can't get upset about every person that dies, otherwise you'd be upset every fucking minute of the day. But what I mean is, you know, people don't want people to die and it's tragic and whatever. So it says, okay, we can get the exact number. For firearms, 33,599, but 63.5% were suicides. So 32.6 were homicides. So let me figure that out right now. So if 33,000 and then we'll move on from this because I don't want to spend too much time on it, but 33,599. And I want to see how many from suicides. 63.5. Because suicides are number 11 or something. So suicides are up there. But not all suicides, obviously, are by gun. So let me do this as a percentage. Or here, move my decimal point. So 21,335, which is just going to give me a circular reference. It shouldn't. 12,264. So it was 2,000 more than what I said. So if I change that number, which that doesn't sound right neither. So maybe it was 2,005 that there were 8,000 because it actually went way down. It's still 0.47% of deaths, which it went up, you know, barely anything, and of total population, it's not going to go up much at all. It went to 0.005% for people over 18 and 0.0038 for the total amount of people. So, assuming that that's the correct number, yes, 12,000 people. It's sad that 12,000 people died. And I know people look at it as, well, they didn't have to die, they were shot. Well, we don't have the specifics on that, first of all. How many were gang-related? How many were, you know, where somebody got into a fight and some idiot pulled a gun, or, you know, someone's friend cheated with their wife and they went and killed, you know, shit like that. So there's, okay, and it's six, it was 16.8%. See, this is really low too, because it was 16.8% of all injuries were from firearms deaths. So think about that for a minute. Oh, and they did an adjustment based on age. The age adjusted death rate. Oh, it decreased. And I don't know what that means. But if you look at injuries, death by injuries, and that would include, you know, you fall down the stairs, you, I don't know, like I said, a ladder falls. I don't know how a ladder would fall on your head. Car accidents, I would think, would fall. Now, well, yeah, it could, it probably would fall into that too. So gun deaths were only 16%, 16.8% of that. This is not a fucking problem. It's not. You have 321 million people living in this fucking country. You have 228 million that are over 18. And out of that, you have 12,000 that kill each other with a gun? And this is some fucking epidemic that we have to waste all these time and resources on? Are you fucking kidding me? Now, again, I wouldn't give a fuck, and I said I would care because I care about people dying, but what I mean is I wouldn't give a fuck as far as my opinion being changed. If 100,000 people died from gun violence, it still wouldn't change my opinion, because I believe in the right of self-defense. I don't know if it's the number one. It probably is, because without self-defense, and people have made these statements all the time. I heard it recently where somebody said something about, you know, you can't protect free speech without, you know, the ability to defend yourself, or without a gun. And it's the truth. So that's really what got me finally to the point where I said, I got to get involved, because I think it was after Sandy Hook, which I had talked about. We're going to do a detailed, in-depth show. I'll probably start it early when I do it. I still haven't got all my information and notes together, but because I want to make sure that as I said, you know, I don't want people to be able to poke holes in my theory. Now, you can, of course, disagree with my theory, but not the facts. There are certain facts that bring me to a conclusion, and I need to make sure that those facts are facts, that they're undebatable or undeniable facts. So there is a, you know, there's a lot of them, videos on YouTube that you can watch about Sandy Hook. And I had said that I used to think that it was just that their story was bullshit, that maybe it was a different shooter or there were multiple shooters or something like that. Now, I'm not so sure that it even happened. And that's based on a whole bunch of facts and coming to a conclusion. And it's even hard for me to say that because I'm like, really? That I believe that they would set up a hoax? Well, if you think about it, they have done false flags, which means that the United States government has done things like, you know, attacks where people were killed and blamed it on somebody else in order to attack them or in order to exploit an agenda. So if they would do that, this isn't even as bad because this is actually, they didn't kill anybody. So if they would do something where they wouldn't kill, they did kill people, why wouldn't they do something where they wouldn't kill anybody? And of course, it makes more sense. You know, why not do something and not kill anybody? It's not as bad. I mean, it's pretty bad how they used it to go after guns, but obviously to not kill somebody is not as bad as to kill somebody. So that's where, why would I not believe that? So there were 200,000 deaths that were injury related. So that counts those gun deaths again, that were 16. See, I'm not understanding. There's like two numbers here. They're pretty close, but one was 16.8 and one 16.5 as far as the percentage of gun deaths by the percentage of injury deaths that were by guns. And then they're saying, and this is hard for me to believe, and I don't know how they come up with these numbers. That's the other thing, too. But that 49,714 persons died of drug-induced cases. This includes deaths from poisoning, okay, and medical conditions caused by the use of illegal drugs, as well as deaths from poisoning due to medical prescribed or other drugs. It includes unintentional injuries, homicides, and other causes indirectly related to drug use, as well as newborn deaths to the mother's drug use. So, okay, well, that kind of changes the number there, where you and then you also have people that it could have been ruled as poison, but they killed themselves, or, you know, an OD, but they meant to OD and they killed themselves, because you can't tell. If somebody ODs, they don't know if they actually OD'd or they tried to kill themselves. Now, that is a high number. However, the breakdown of that would be better to have, and I think we kind of have some of that. No, that gives me all cancer numbers. Yeah, see, it's including alcohol and diseases that were caused. So it's saying if from alcohol you got, like, because it says leukemia under this. And it's under drug-induced cases. So it's saying, what, if you got leukemia somehow from fucking alcohol use, that it counted that. See, the drug numbers I question. I really do, because I need more specifics on what they are, but it's still the same thing where regardless of what the numbers are, and even 50,000, including all of those. See, that's not an accurate number to use because of what it's including. So if somebody were just to give me the number of people that actually OD'd or died directly as a result from taking the drug, because you can't say really for sure, with the exception of maybe alcohol, which is legal, you can't really say for sure if a drug killed somebody or not unless it's a straight up OD. And then even then, it could be a combination of drugs. So to use that number, I don't think would be accurate. But even if you did, it's still not in the top 15. It is kind of right below it. But yeah, I have to, because a lot of these are alcohol-induced. It seems like more deaths that they're, the way they're counting this, are from alcohol than anything else. And again, alcohol is what's legal. So if you go back to what we were talking about, you know, oh, the drug problem and whatever, and, you know, all of these people that supposedly are ODing, because that is not the amount of people that OD'd. But even if we take a percentage of that and we say, I've heard they try to say like 40,000 or something like that, which, again, you're talking about other factors that go into that. Now, really, the higher the amount of people that are ODing, I would say that that is a reason as to why you should legalize it than anything else. Now, the media, again, same thing. They look at drugs, and it was something like one of the documentaries, and I think it was from 2015, was saying like 5% of people use like heroin or something. It was some number that was pretty low percentage wise. Now, that 5%, when you're talking about 321 million, adds up, obviously, because that would be what, per 100,000, that would be 5 million people. So it would be over 15 million people. However, if you say there's 15, see, and this is what they'll do too. Usually they won't give percentages because this was a documentary, but they'll give numbers. Because if they give numbers, it sounds worse. So if you say 15 million people are addicted to heroin, be like, oh, shit, that's a lot of people. That sounds bad. But if you put that in context, that that's only 5% of the population, it doesn't sound that bad. And that's the whole thing. And on top of that, we've already gone through this, I don't know how many fucking times, that the majority of the problems with drugs are because they are illegal, meaning that people are getting tainted drugs or drugs that are cut with fucked up things. They can't afford them because the price goes up on black market items. There was another thing too. Oh, they risk getting arrested. So that, would factor in as well. So all of these things that they use as reasons as to why drugs should be illegal are really reasons as to why they should be legal. And I don't want to, I've talked so much about drugs in the past few months, especially with what went on with Kratom. I don't want to spend a lot of time on it, especially when we're running out of time. But the bottom line is it's the same thing with drugs. Even in those documentaries, I'm surprised they even gave like a percentage. Maybe people think that's a lot. But what the media wants you to think is that, you know, oh, this is an epidemic. There's so many people doing. Because they said that on the same shit that now heroin's this new, not a new drug, but it's people have gone back to heroin and it's the most popular drug now. And now it's an epidemic and whatever. And then they say something like 5% of people use it. I'm like, 5% of people? And people, and that's not even deceiving. But all the other shit is. And all of these things, they present it like the drug dealers are poisoning the kids and they're doing this in our neighborhood and we need to stop them and stop the cartels from importing stuff and we need to stop this. No, all you're doing is you're making it so people that aren't criminals go to jail, they go broke, and they could end up ODing or getting a bad packet of heroin. So, it's crazy. And, you know, when it comes to, again, the percentage of the population, it's nothing. Drugs are, when is something considered a problem? How many people, see, you can't even say how many people, because it's got to be, you got to put that in perspective of the population. And that's really the whole point of tonight, is the amount of deaths and the amount of people, and putting that in perspective when they talk about all this shit. They talk about terrorism. How many incidents of terrorism have happened in the United States in reality? Now, if you don't count the ones that were false flags, and you somehow, along with that, I'm trying to type, somehow you count the Orlando shooting at a nightclub, at a gay nightclub, that is impossible that it was pulled off. And you count the other American person that was born in America that, according to the police and the news, was a ISIS sympathizer. And that's according to them. Who knows when to fucking believe them and when not to believe them? Because I don't. I don't believe anything the police say. They could be saying something true. I don't believe them. Because if somebody lies over and over again, when do you believe them? Well, never. Because they're pathological liars, essentially. I mean, the police aren't literally pathological liars. They don't lie because they have an issue with lying. They lie because what they do is illegal and bad. And or in Orlando, and I talked about this with Ken Shorjan, who joins us every other Wednesday to talk about geopolitics and the economy, that, you know, there's no way that that guy could have done that shooting. And as somebody who has shot, you know, an AR-15 as well, same with Adam Lanza, who is, you know, with Sandy Hook, that there were some weird things in the timeline, and the SWAT team all of a sudden just raided the place. I guarantee you the SWAT team killed half the people, if not more. But they're not going to tell you that. They're going to tell you he did it all, which is impossible. But you're supposed to believe the police. And so many people, why do you just believe everything the police say? People have gotten to the point where they don't believe what politicians say, although you still have people that believe that. Like, there are reporters or street reporters or whatever that ask people if they trust a politician, or they do polls. Do you trust a politician? Who the fuck would trust a politician? Are you kidding me? Some fucking guy you don't know that's running for office? Do you trust him? I don't give a fuck if you're voting for him or not. Why would you trust him? Why would you vote for him? Why would you believe anything some guy that you don't know, that all you know about him is what they report on the fucking news, and you're going to say that you trust him to basically run your life? What are you, fucking nuts? What is wrong with you? So I'm going to try to get through these other things I have real quick that all relate to the population, and really try to skew people's view of the world. Because, again, they do it by not putting things in context. You know, they see murders all the time, or this all the time, or that all the time. And, you know, even if there's a murder a day, that's only 365 murders a year. That is nothing. Now, yes, to the families, and I know we're talking about people's lives. But again, you know, when 2.6 million people get murdered, and not murdered, die, and the, you know, another year I looked at previously was like 2.5. I mean, it's somewhere between, probably over the last 5 to 10 years, it's probably 2 million to 2.6, you know, somewhere in the 2 million range of people that die. And a million of them are from heart disease and cancer. Almost 50% are from that. It's funny because I don't see anybody fucking doing commercials about how bad, you know, fast food is. I mean, what's more dangerous for you? Because a lot more people are dying of heart disease than they are heroin. And heroin is poison and is meant to be poison. They don't give you the, you know, you don't have an actual chemist who knows what he's doing that created the heroin directly from a poppy. No, you have some fucking, you know, ghetto chemist. Well, first you have some guy who, you know, harvests it, does some stuff to it, maybe not as bad as what happens to it later. Then it goes to the ghetto. Then they do their own mixture to it. And you have all this shit that happens to it. But you still have more people dying from heart attacks. And what causes heart attacks? Well, I'm sure the majority of those people were overweight and ate like shit. But for some reason, people care so much about guns and drugs and things like that, that the government can make money off of and have all of these agencies to go fight than the people that die of heart attacks, because that doesn't benefit them. Even though when you're looking at it in perspective and compared to population, the amount of heart attacks and it compared to the amount of deaths, I mean, it's almost 25% of deaths. That's high. So, again, putting things in perspective, I never hear, you know, occasionally you'll hear a story and you had that Supersize Me movie, but that was, and I didn't see it, but that was an independent filmmaker who had to go and, you know, do something like that. And I think he was more out to, or at least the studio or whoever put up the money just wanted to attack a corporation. It wasn't really about the food. So that's putting things in perspective as far as how they are. So you have things like polls. How the fuck can you even, you know, what they interview 3,500 people or something like that, and all of a sudden they know all this shit? Now, with elections, they seem to be close. A lot of it's exit polling. So, but with other shit, I take them with a grain of salt. I don't know. The amount of successful people. If you watch TV, now this is not news, but if you watch TV, everybody's successful almost. Everybody has all this shit. And then you think about it, and then you have poor people that go into ridiculous amounts of debt trying to get all these things they see on TV because they think everybody should have them. Because everybody on TV has them. But when you look at the percentage of the population that is under the poverty line, the percentage of population, I think it was 70% can't come up with $1,000. That's huge. Maybe it was 60, but it was pretty high. The economy is always, you know, whether it's, and in relation to the population, it's, you know, the amount of people working and things like that, the amount of people underemployed. They don't show any of that. You know, they go by the numbers that make it look good. A lot of times it's the stock market, which just gets propped up by the banks. One of the things that I've been kind of mentioning it throughout this whole thing, that they definitely use to make people think that they need police, they need government, and that things are so dangerous is the amount of crime, murder, and rape that they show on the news. And again, when you look at that compared to the percentage of population, now, if you're looking at a specific area and the population of that area and it's a high crime area, that does happen. But in general, most of the areas, the majority of areas, besides, you know, there's a lot of areas in the cities that are bad, but they're trying to make you think wherever you go, it's dangerous because every day there's a murder. But just because every day there's a murder, and even if that murder is not even in your, you know, neighborhood or nowhere near it, it's just in the fucking city that you live in that may have 3 to 4 million people, but they want to scare you into believing that it's dangerous wherever you go. And again, they don't put it in perspective of, you know, the amount of people compared to the amount of crime. Because the majority of people are not doing crime. That's the whole thing. You have a very small percentage of people. However, because there's so many fucking people that live in the country, which also leads into my next thing about voting, you know, it leaves a lot more people that commit crimes, but they're a small percentage compared to the amount of people in the U.S. So I'm going to just go through two things real quick, and that's it, that are related, and then end the show because we're way over time, actually, if I count from, you know, the 2 hours. But I said I would stay till at least 9:30, but we're past that, and I need to get to sleep, but or go through my my before I go to sleep ritual. It's not actually a ritual. It's a getting ready for bed. So you look at that population, and I had said, what, 288 million people are over 18? That's the amount of people that can vote for president, and you really think your vote makes a difference? Now, that's not the amount of people that do vote, because that's not registered voters. That's the amount of people that can vote. Now, of course, a lot of people don't vote. But even when it comes to anybody in federal government, first of all, you're dealing with the smallest vote probably being at least 300,000 that are represented. Now, not all 300,000 people are eligible to vote and do vote, but let's say even half of them. You know, 150,000 and you have some say. Now, when you get into state elections and local elections, you have smaller districts, so there's less people voting in it. But still, the country has become an oligarchy, and there's been a study on this, and I've talked about it before. And one of the polls, even though, like I said, I'm not a big fan of polls, but I mentioned this one before. And actually, somebody who listened to one of the shows said it's, and this kind of proves my point, said it's kind of bullshit because Trump packs arenas. So if there's 321 million people in the country and Trump packs arenas, let's say Trump did 100 arenas, right, that fit on average 30,000 people. That's only 300,000 people. That's not even 1% of the population. It's nothing. So the poll had said that the majority of people don't like Hillary or Donald Trump. And I use that as another reason or another, not reason, but more support of how the country's an oligarchy. Because if you're getting the candidates that you don't even like, obviously it's all controlled, it's all rigged, and it's all decided, and they put these candidates in front of you, and then they go off and they make whatever fucking laws they want, and they do whatever they want. And that's fucking the reality of it. But nobody wants to face that shit. They want to sit there in fucking denial and say, yeah, vote. And why do you think they want all these people to vote? So they can say, one, I mean, look at all the people that participate and look at all the people that believe in this process. And then the winner can say the majority of the people support me. Obama didn't even get the majority of, I think, registered voters' votes because a lot of registered voters didn't vote. So to say that, because he made some statement, well, you know, I can do what I want, basically, because I got elected. The majority of the people elected me. Well, no, they didn't. The majority of registered voters that actually voted elected you. Because the majority of people are not voting, and they're showing that, hey, we don't want you. We don't want this. Now, again, the scary part of that is a lot of those people want communism and things like that, and that's why. And that obviously is an issue as far as I'm concerned. But when it comes to being against government, there's a lot of people that are against the current government, but they're not against government in general. They're just against the current government. They want a socialist government. They want, you know, a government that is going to do the redistribution of wealth and all of the things that they want and all of that. And they don't see that happening, and they didn't see people cooperating with Obama, and that's why they don't like things. So they say. Now, that might be another thing that the media distorts. We don't know how many people truly support what I define as true freedom and liberty. I don't know. I have no idea. I think it's a very small number. But I could be totally fucking wrong. They want me to think it's a small number, whether it is or not. I do know that. But I, it could be a small number or it could not be. I know that you don't see any shows about it, but that doesn't mean anything. You don't see any media channels about it, but that doesn't mean anything neither, because they're going to suppress it as much as possible. They brainwash you in school. They suppress it. You really only get the view of government media except for on the internet. And government media then distorts things by making you think all of these things that aren't true because they don't put them in perspective. They make you think that, you know, certain things happen all the time. Like people watch the news. Oh, another shooting. People are getting shot all the time. I doubt that. Probably, I'm trying to think of the number, but that, you know, over 90% of people that are anti-gun know the actual percentage of people that are killed by guns of the percentage of the population and of the percentage of people that die. Now, I don't know that for a fact. That's just me guessing an estimate. But that's what I think. But of course, when it comes down to it, what the fuck does it matter what I think? And in some ways, it really doesn't. It does, but it matters what I think just as much as it matters what you think, because I can't do this by myself, and neither can anybody else. So more people need to stand up if that's what you believe in. I don't generally tell people what to do. I say do whatever you want. But if you believe in freedom and liberty, it's time to stand up. It's been time. Make your voice heard. Get involved somehow. Fuck, get involved with the show. Do your own show. Do your own show on my network. I'm looking for shows. So go to nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Thanks, everybody. Appreciate you tuning in. Have a good night.
And at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply.